Good evening, everybody. Today is a special evening because we have a special invitee in the form of a speaker who has got a multifaceted talents and the profession, Mr. Sanjay Pinto. Mr. Sanjay Pinto is a practicing advocate right now at the Madras High Court, where he specializes in criminal, constitutional, corporate, arbitration, consumer, and more importantly, media laws. Before donning the black gown, Mr. Sanjay was the resident editor of NDTV 24/7 and also the executive editor of NDTV Hindu. A household name and the face of NDTV in South India for over 15 years, Mr. Sanjay has reported breaking news developments from South India. Mr. Sanjay has anchored a slew of popular news bulletins and signature programs on NDTV. He has many laurels to be proud of. A legal columnist of the Deccan Chronicle with more than 216 published legal columns as of now, and a columnist of Reds Magazine, a political analyst on national TV channels, and author of famous books titled My NDTV Days, Justice for All, and Speakers Are Made and Not Born. And Mr. Sanjay Pinto is also a mentor of the Silver Tongue Academy resources that mentors youngsters in public speaking. Mr. Sanjay was the national debating champion and gold medalist with a record of 106 gold medals and victories in the intercollegiate debates representing Loyola College and Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, and is a recipient of Rotary Awards for his excellence in the field of media and law. And that is not the end of the what is called a list of achievements of Mr. Sanjay. It goes on. Mr. Sanjay represented India in the IVLP program on the rules of law and judicial reforms in the USA in the year 2014. And Mr. Sanjay is a guest lecturer on media law at national law schools in India. And Mr. Sanjay is the legal and media advisor of the Friends of Police Movement in Tamil Nadu. So I'm very happy to have Mr. Sanjay as the resource person today. Mr. Sanjay, the forum is yours.
Thank you very much, sir. There were three dogs, one from America, the second from Russia, and the third from China. And all of them were granted a boon, a wish each. The dog from America said, "I want 8 hours of sleep." The dog from Russia said, "I want the juiciest bones to chew on." The dog from China said, "Look, I have enough to eat. I have enough sleep. All I want to do is to be able to bark." Now, ladies and gentlemen, that precisely sums up the state of freedom of speech and expression, particularly in our country. Many years ago, A.G. Gardner, in his essay on the rule of the road, I said that, you know, this freedom to swing your arm ends at the tip of the other person's nose. But today, I often ask people, what if our noses grow like the fictional character Pinocchio? That is hardly any room left to swing, let alone maneuver. In India, we know that freedom of speech and expression is not merely granted, but guaranteed as a fundamental right to every citizen under Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution. But then free speech is not a free for all, because this speech is actually not absolute. It is hemmed in by reasonable restrictions. And these reasonable restrictions constitute that constitutional line of control. Reasonable restrictions, about nine of them enumerated under Article 19(2) of the Constitution, right from friendly unity and sovereignty of the country, security of the state, friendly relations with other countries, defamation, incitement to commit offenses, contempt of court, public order, and morality. But the biggest Damocles sword, as it were, that hangs over freedom of speech and expression is defamation. Now, defamation, as we know, can be used as a sword, it can be used as a shield, and it's used in both cases in our country. Section 499 of the Indian Penal Code defines defamation as words spoken or written or signs or visible representations And there again, there are certain fundamental requirements to constitute the fundamental ingredients of an offense under 499 IPC. And that is, there has to be publication. There has to be an intention to damage somebody's reputation or knowledge that it could damage somebody's reputation. Very interestingly, in the 1960s, in a case of the US Supreme Court, New York Times versus Sullivan, it was held that what is merely incorrect is not necessarily defamatory. That there has to be reckless disregard for the truth. There has to be malice. And this judgment, in fact, came to be used, cited across the world by champions of free speech. And in several judgments, even in India, it's still being referred to. Now, the Supreme Court, in its wisdom, in Subramanian Swami versus Union of India, had refused to decriminalize defamation, primarily on two grounds. One, that freedom of speech is subject to somebody's reputation, and that there are enough safeguards in the law to actually stop any misuse of this provision. Subramanian Swami versus Union of India. Now, we all know that after the Justice Puttusamy versus Union of India judgment, today privacy is a fundamental right. So in the context of reputation of a person, privacy as a fundamental right is paramount. The defamation is of two kinds, criminal defamation and civil defamation. Under criminal defamation, there are 10 exceptions, fair comment being an important one in this context, also issues of good faith and of raising issues in public interest and where public questions are involved. Now, these 10 exceptions are pretty exhaustive. As far as civil defamation is concerned, there are damages. But unfortunately, in our country, unlike, let's say, the UK, where cases are fast-tracked and can get over even in 6 months, here it's not the case. And there you can even go bankrupt if you have a civil defamation case filed against you. In India, it's very different. Seldom do they really see the light of day. Now, I would like to confine my lecture over the next 45 minutes to six main parts. One is how freedom of speech and expression plays out in the print media, the role of live telecast and electronic media, artistic freedom through film censorship and literary freedom when it comes to books, controversial books, the role of the social media and defamation and abuse. Then I'll talk about trial by the media, and finally, the right to protest as a means of expression. Now, when it comes to print media, we know that this freedom of speech and expression is not just for the newspapers or the magazines or the media barons. It extends to readers at large. So freedom of expression extends to readers, the consumers of news put out. Now, when under the Press and Registration of Books Act 1867, in fact, this is often used in defamation cases. Strangely enough, even in cases of the electronic media and TV channels, people still do a cut, copy, paste and still invoke the Press and Registration of Books Act, which is legally incorrect. Now, there under the Press and Registration of Books Act, it's very important that you need to specify the names of the persons responsible for the selection of news. Often in newspapers, you'll find that notification that comes out, persons responsible for selection of news. So when you file for defamation, you need to mention these persons' names. The Supreme Court, we know in that landmark judgment of State of Haryana versus Bhajan Lal, had listed about 7 or 8 main grounds under which criminal cases can be quashed under Section 482 of the Criminal Procedure Code. Now, when you have a criminal defamation case against you, a lot of people seem to think that, and this is a misconception, that the power of the court is limited. It is narrow. I am of the opinion, if you look at actually the wording of 482 CRPC, it says no limit. There can be no limit placed on the power of the court or higher judiciary to invoke its inherent powers. So while that power may be discretionary, it is unlimited and it is wide. And two very interesting judgments were passed by the Madras High Court recently. Grievance Redressal Officer versus Krishnamurti. Just a few couple of weeks back, where Justice G.R. Swaminathan, one of the most brilliant judgments I have read, where Justice Swaminathan virtually put himself into the shoes of a common citizen, where he says that the right, the inherent power to quash a case, it is not merely the exercise of an inherent power, but also the court must exert itself a little bit, because an unused law is useless tinsel. I mean, these are beautiful words. You read the entire judgment. It's a fascinating judgment. And almost on cue, a few days later, there was another case, N. Ram and others versus State of Tamil Nadu, Union of India and State of Tamil Nadu, where Justice Abdul Quddus again quashed a number of cases, a batch of cases against various sections of the media, print and others. There again, Justice Abdul Quddus makes a very interesting point where he says that public officials must have a thick skin. They must have a thick skin and shouldn't be offended by mere criticism or fair comment. And, you know, a long pending grievance of many people has been that there is a discriminatory provision in section 199 of the CRPC, which makes a distinction between public officials and ordinary citizens. Now, in this judgment of N. Ram and of the Madras High Court, the distinction is made where it very clearly says under section 199, subsection 2, defamation, can, if it's against the state, can be filed through the public prosecutor. But under 199 subsection 6, if it's personal defamation, that clause can be used. So it's not that all public officials must necessarily file defamation cases against the media only through the public prosecutor. Now, as far as the electronic media is concerned, we know that there's a lot of criticism. People have become largely disenchanted with sections of the electronic media. A lot of people, in fact, say that you know, there's a slanging match which happens on prime time, which is to a large extent true because news anchors in the court of public opinion are judge, jury and executioner themselves. Now, there's a very interesting case that I was part of. In fact, when I was executive editor of NDTV Hindu, I was slapped with a criminal defamation case. And I went to the Madras High Court and it was quashed, Sanjay Pinto versus A. Kamaraj, where one of the reporters had, you know, done some live reportage on the field in an evolving story. And then later on, the person aggrieved filed a case against me and my second in command. So we went to the court and there the court held that, you know, vicarious liability is alien to criminal law. In this case, it was one of the first cases in the country where the court actually analyzed the role of an editor in a live telecast. If it is not possible to edit what is live, how can you be legally liable for what goes out in a live telecast? Because the role of an editor, a lot of people think that the electronic media has no editors. That is incorrect. There are editors. But then your role is limited to briefing reporters in a news meeting, deciding on headlines, guiding them as to how, you know, the internal codes of conduct, editorial codes. But beyond that, apart from your due diligence, you cannot really, it's a sped arrow when a live telecast is happening there. So you can't control, unlike a newspaper editor who can vet a copy before it goes into print. Here it's happening on the spur of the moment. So therefore, there's no scope to edit what is live. And therefore, the Madras High Court was pleased to quash that criminal defamation case on the grounds of vicarious liability and also on grounds of malicious prosecution and a few other issues. Now, in this grievance redressal officer versus Krishnamurti, in fact, the Honorable Judge referred to the Sullivan case. He also referred to another landmark division bench Madras High Court decision in R. Rajagopal versus J. Jayalalitha. 2006, where they again reiterated this principle of reckless disregard, that everything, mere factual inaccuracies do not necessarily lend themselves to defamation and criminal defamation at that. Now, as far as the live telecast is concerned, we know that there is actually the electronic media, unlike the press council or the print media, has no regulatory body with statutory regulatory body in that sense. Of course, there are internal, there's an internal organization, the News Broadcasters Association. You have also rival associations that have sprung up. Very interestingly, a few days ago, a petition was filed in court that seeking a plea to get prior sanction from the press council or the you know, the electronic media bodies before you file defamation, almost like a sanction to prosecute, as it were. How that will play out is something we'll have to eagerly wait and watch. Now, the third aspect of my talk today is on artistic freedom and films. I'll start with film censorship. We know that before any high profile film comes into being, there is a parallel self-styled centers who come up. Parallel self-styled centers. We've seen that in several films in the past. There was Lipstick Under My Burqa. There was Padmavati, became Padmavat later on. In fact, the Supreme Court in M.L. Sharma versus Sanjay Leela Bansali had upheld artistic license. sensors, ladies and gentlemen, are meant to use, sparingly use the scissors and not a sledgehammer, as it were. Because the Central Board of Film Certification draws its authority from the Cinematograph Act. And under Section 5B of the Cinematograph Act, the board can actually refuse to give certification for exhibition of a film under certain categories. Now, this Section 5B is virtually a cut, copy, paste of Article 19.2 of the Constitution. All those reasonable restrictions have been imported from there, and they form the basis of Section 5B of the Cinematograph Act. There are also guidelines of the Censor Board, which were updated, I am told, more than 2 decades ago. And there are certain clauses. Clause 1B talks about the censors giving not unduly curbing artistic freedom. Clause 1C talks about the Censor Board being responsive to social changes. Then you have clause 3, 1 and 2, which talk about films being judged in their entirety and in that context, the period in which it is made and contemporary social standards. Now, there are often criticisms. In fact, there was the Censor Board even came up with a list of cuss words that should not be used in films, very interestingly. But in some landmark decisions of the Supreme Court, there is K. Abbas, for instance, versus Union of India, where the court, in fact, very clearly said that it's not the elements of rape, sexuality, and morality, immorality, which should attract the censor's scissors, as much as how the theme is handled by the producer, by the director. Now, to illustrate the consequences of an evil, sometimes it's necessary to show offenses in their true form, which is why the Supreme Court in Bobby Art International versus Ompal Singh, better known as the Poolan Devi case, said that the rape scene helps to explain the real gravity of that offense. And sometimes if certain objectionable words are used, swear words are used, which we can hear in every street corner today, one shouldn't get too touchy. We shouldn't be prickly pears. And that's the essence of what the Supreme Court in the Poolan Devi Bandit Queen case had to say. Talking of literary freedom, we have our own example here, Perumal Murugan case, where in a brilliant, I think a landmark, one of the biggest judgments for free speech passed by the then Chief Justice of the Madras High Court, Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul, in the Perumal Murugan case, where he in fact spoke about, he issued 5 broad guidelines for governments when it comes to dealing with public order and protests that erupt over literary freedom. But he very clearly in that judgment spoke about non-state players should not be allowed to actually hold the state to ransom to determine what is permissible and what is not permissible. So these are the main judgments that actually guide literary freedom, both in terms of film censorship and also in terms of books and books that are controversial. And now comes my favorite part, the social media. There was a time when opinions used to be only on editorials of newspapers and to some extent for the common man, the letters to the editor column of newspapers. And then you had the social media. And of course, the electronic media where they wear their editorial stance on their primetime debate shows. Now, the social media has made every user an editor-in-chief of his or her own views. And therein lies the problem. There is no regulation on the social media. You mention regulation and you'll be told. It's a bad word. But when lawyers, when we can have, we can be subject to regulations of the Bar Council, when doctors can come under the Medical Council, when advertisers can come under the Advertising Standards Council of India, when insurance companies can come under the IRDA, when the press can come under the Press Council, why should the social media be without any regulation by an external body? Their terms of use, their community standards are too loose. You flag any content, most content on the social media, Twitter or Facebook, then you'll immediately get a notification that says this is not against, this doesn't violate our community standards. So you often wonder what on earth are their community standards? They are pretty lenient, I must say, because there's a lot of concern about fake news, about abuse, because there has to be a distinction on the social media, a distinction drawn between dissent. Dissent is fine. You may disagree with me, but abuse is not. Because a whole lot of IPC sections will be attracted if you actually go into the social media. I often jocularly tell people that if you suffer from low blood pressure, a surest cure is to get onto Twitter, sign up on Twitter. And here in a very interesting case, to deal with this, the Information Technology Act had Section 66A, 66A, which spoke about, among other things, annoyance, causing annoyance. But then we know what happened in that Bombay case during Bal Thackeray's funeral. Two college girls, one of them wrote a piece, a very critical piece about how the city of Mumbai was shut down and questioned that. Another friend of hers liked that post, and both of them were detained in a police station. There was a nationwide outcry. And finally, it took a young law student, Shreya Singhal, to go to the Supreme Court in what has become another landmark case, Shreya Singhal versus Union of India, where the Supreme Court struck down that draconian Section 66A of the IT Act. So now that doesn't exist. Of course, there are other provisions of the IT Act on pornography and obscenity and all that. But the Supreme Court very clearly again made a point that you cannot have a chilling effect on freedom of speech and expression, which is a fundamental right, the chilling effect. Now, there are a lot of people who use the social media. In fact, you find a template on most social media profiles is retweets are not endorsements, received as forwarded. People should understand that when you retweet something or when you forward something, which perhaps could be defamatory content, you could actually be instrumental in constituting republication. So you're not really off the hook. There's no legal immunity that you confer on yourself by mentioning that retweets are not endorsements or these disclaimers. Really, I don't think will be legally tenable. It's as good or as bad as carrying an umbrella during a cyclone. Then there is another aspect of administrators of WhatsApp groups. Here, I must say that there's a lot of, in fact, a false alarm being circulated that administrators of WhatsApp groups can be arrested and all that. I am of the opinion that it is only the intermediary. The intermediary of WhatsApp is not the administrator. The intermediary is WhatsApp itself. If you look at the definition of intermediary under Section 2W of the IT Act, it lists, content providers, it lists all these platforms as intermediaries, not the person, not an administrator, because there cannot be vicarious liability in criminal law. For instance, let me give you a scenario. A person is an administrator of a WhatsApp group of a school or college alumni association. Now, people reside all over the world in different time zones. You don't obviously expect the administrator to be policing content 24/7. All he can do is, if there is any content which is deemed objectionable, he can warn that person, he can put out general guidelines, and perhaps he can ask that person to delete content. Beyond that, he's really not in a position to police it round the clock. So, in fact, the Delhi High Court, in fact, Justice Rajiv Endla Sahai, a beautiful judgment of Ajay Bhalla. In fact, he gave us a very interesting analogy. He said, to make WhatsApp administrators liable for defamatory content is as bad as making the manufacturer of newsprint liable for defamatory content in newspapers. Now, another very interesting aspect, in fact, this was in fact suggested by the host, Mr. Srinivas Raghavan, that I deal with this aspect when comes to freedom of expression, trial by the media. Trial by the media is a term is a fancy term that's bandied about every time we look at media and how responsible they are. Having been on the other side of the fence myself, having made the transition from the newsroom to the courtroom, as it were, I must say that the primary responsibility and role of the media is reporting, not adjudication. Let me say that again. The media's job is reporting and not adjudication. There is the Contempt of Courts Act, Section 2C, which very clearly bars any prejudicial act or interference with the course of justice or any obstruction to the administration of justice. Section 2C of the Contempt of Courts Act is very clear. Whether we need that act or not, whether it's a Canolian hangover that needs to stay on, is a different matter and a subject for another debate another day. Then you have Sections 3.1, which talk about exempting innocent publication, and Section 4, which protects fair and accurate reporting of judicial proceedings. Now, there's a very important practical aspect, ladies and gentlemen, when it comes to trial by the media. When the suspect's images or photographs are published in advance, this may adversely affect an identification parade. And this issue was flagged by the Supreme Court in Siddhartha Vashishth alias Manu Sharma versus State of NCT, better known as the Jessica Lal case. Then you had, in fact, a retired Supreme Court judge, Justice Swatantra Kumar, when he was NGT chairperson, versus Indian Express Limited and others, where the court very clearly held that you can affect prejudicially affect the public mind, and there's real and tangible risk of the plaintiff not getting a fair trial, because we know that an essential feature of a fair trial is no bias involved there. Interestingly, the Law Commission of India in its 200th report spoke about the concept of a spent arrow, that even after a person is acquitted in a case, undoing the damage caused by their reputation cannot be undone really. So therefore, this trial by the media needs to take a step back and introspect. It really calls for introspection, and there have been judgments in the past, much before the advent of the electronic media and the social media. For instance, there were two judgments, Supreme Court, Saibal Gupta versus B.K. Sen, where the court said, it used the term mischievous. It said it would be mischievous for a newspaper to systematically conduct an independent investigation. Then the Punjab High Court in Rao Harinarayan Singh said that the liberty of the press is subordinate to the proper administration of justice. Of course, as I said earlier, these are judgments that came before the advent of TV channels and the social media. And finally, the last aspect that I'd like to deal with, because I'd like to have more time allocated for questions to make it more interactive as possible, the right to protest. We've seen that during the Citizenship Amendment Act, this came under the scanner again, freedom of speech and expression. An integral part of free speech and expression is the ability of a citizen to register his protest. The right to expression, freedom of expression, also includes perhaps the right to offend, as long as you're within the four corners of the law. Now, the right to assemble peaceably and without arms, to hold placards and to shout slogans, is under Article 19(1)(b). But like 19(1)(a), this is also subject to reasonable restrictions. The constitutional LOC for 19(1)(b) is that the principal law, in fact, that there has to be a nexus with two things. One, sovereignty and integrity of the country, and two, public order. But then public order is often used to actually deny people this fundamental right. I am of the opinion that the bigger threat to public order is not from people gathering in a public place and shouting slogans or holding placards. The bigger threat to public order, in my opinion, is to stifle anger. So pent-up emotions are a greater threat to public order than expression of emotions and expression of dissent or whatever. There's a beautiful Mexican proverb that says, they buried us, but they didn't know that we were seeds. It's like the champagne bottle theory. The more you suppress someone, the greater is the urge to come out and protest. And very rightly, the Supreme Court and Anita Thakur versus government of Jammu and Kashmir had said that in the land of the do or die movement, salt satyagraha, the right to protest is no jural anathema. And in fact, she even referred to that being, and in the satyagraha being an important ingredient, the important weapon in the fight for independence. Now, just like there is this dictum in criminal law, bail is the norm and jail is the exception. When it comes to permission for processions and demonstrations, permission is a norm and refusal is the exception. This Madras High Court in Durai Shankar versus Director General of Police 2014 very clearly held that rejection is the exception and permission is a norm. How does this play out today in our state? It may be very different. Not difficult, ladies and gentlemen, to actually label any group of protesters as an unlawful assembly. But if you look at the definition of unlawful assembly in section 141 of the IPC, everybody talks about, at least in common parlance, that an unlawful assembly is a gathering of five or more people. But actually, what is important is also the other aspect of 141, which is a common object. The common object should fall under five categories. They should try to overawe by criminal force any government or legislature or public servant. They need to resist the execution of any law or legal process. They need to commit mischief. They need to commit criminal trespass or take possession of any property or to compel people to do something which they are legally not empowered to do. So these are the five categories under which the an unlawful assembly should actually be, there should be prima facie proof of their having to do all this. Secondly, these peaceful processions and demonstrations, many demonstrations, they start off being peaceful and later on they end up with a lot of perhaps troublemakers infiltrating. We've seen that even during the Jallikattu protest, which was largely peaceful, on the last day, the last leg, things went wrong. So an assembly which is not unlawful when it assembled may subsequently become an unlawful assembly. This is there, in fact, in the explanation to 141 IPC. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to quote Justice Jackson of the US Supreme Court. He said, the function of the government the function of the government is not to keep citizens from falling into error. It is a function of citizens to keep the government from falling into error. And in terms of freedom of speech and expression, as I've taken you through all these different prisms from the print media and the electronic media to artistic freedom and media trial, ultimately I'd like to quote, beautiful punchlines from a movie, American President, where he says in that speech, in that press conference, he says, "You want free speech? Let me see you acknowledge a man whose words make your blood boil and who's standing center stage and advocating at the top of his lungs that which you spent a lifetime advocating at the top of yours." I think today, when it comes to freedom of speech and expression, the media, particularly the media, has an important role to play. They should be a watchdog. They are a watchdog. That's why you have the checks and balances in our democracy. But that watchdog should not become a lapdog. They should not become cheerleaders. The laws of defamation should not really hang over their heads like a Damocles sword. At the same time, they need to also be hemmed in wherever required, and they don't turn into bloodhounds. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pinto. I should say that it is short and sweet and concise and precise. And whatever encomium we have paid in the introduction is proved to be 100% right. You are a proven debater, and with clarity of thought and clarity of expression, salute you for the exuberant lecture.
Thank you, sir.
And I want to shoot the first question. I have no doubt, Mr. Sanjay, that the freedom of expression is freedom of speech is something very much essential in a democracy and a country like India. But what I find as a matter of note of disturbance is that people, we have double standard when it comes to freedom of expression. I don't mean the courts or the governments. For example, when M.F. Hussain painted some nude pictures of Hindu gods, the society was divided into two. One sort of people supported him, another sort of people opposed him. Finally, he was driven away from the country. And when it came to Kamal Haasan in Vishwarupam, the picture was totally different. The government itself took a stand against Kamal, whether actually finally when the movie came out, it was nothing about any particular religion or something. And when the matter came to Da Vinci Code, again, it was a matter of Christians taking a different stand. So what I find that Indians never feel like Indians. They see only as per the faith they profess, or the ideology they follow, or the political party they belong to. Do you think that we are united as Indians, or we stand divided according to the ideology or the religion or the principle we follow? This is the question I want to ask you innocently, if you don't mind, or if I'm not inquisitive.
I think the medium is a message in this case. As I said at the outset, when I spoke about artistic freedom, you have a rent-a-court brigade which comes into play. You have a lot of vested interests which immediately stage protests. Many of them don't even know why they are protesting. So That is a real threat which the courts have dealt with. In the Sanjay Leela Balsari case, the Padmavat case, the Supreme Court very clearly said that. In fact, even Justice Kaul in the Perumal Murugan case said, spoke about these non-state actors. These non-state actors really run riot, and the government should not succumb. I think it's important to go with those the five recommendations which Justice Kaul made in the Perumal Murugan judgment, where he spoke about constituting a committee. See, who are actually the members of the film? Why is it you have to have censorship? Once a censor board takes an informed decision to allow a film, whatever reason, and they advocate cuts and all that, why should we have a parallel censor board in the form of these people who very often are just troublemakers who want to, get the publicity and want to really, many of them come into the limelight only because of this, they write piggyback on somebody else's success. That said, I must say that there has to be a golden mean. I think the media is a very powerful platform and an instrument that is meant for social change. I always believe that if you want to reform society, you must inform society. But at the same time, when it comes to religious sentiments, we are a deeply religious country. There's no getting away from that. Suppose somebody is to make a film wounding my sentiments, I wouldn't like it. So I think when it comes to religious sentiments, and that's why you have the IPC has several provisions which actually penalize wounding religious feelings and all that. Recently, there was a bakery that came into the news. A person was arrested because he put out a, advertisement saying that, you know, Muslims are not being are not employed in this bakery. So I think when it comes to religious sentiments, we need to take a step back. And the solution perhaps will lie in what Justice Kaul had suggested in that judgment. Let a government, let every state government have a proper committee of intellectuals or well-meaning people drawn from different sections of society. Let them have lawyers, let them have doctors, let them have artists, let them have a broad section, a cross-section of people to actually deliberate and see whether there's anything objectionable. If at all you have to have another parallel censorship process, as it were, let it be by people who are well-informed and people who are reasonably progressive. Because even the censor board guidelines, now I have a problem even with the censor board, the guidelines, which in fact you had the Khosla committee, you had the Sham Benegal committee, they talk about different classifications, UA, UA plus 12, UA plus 15. During a children's movie, for instance, when I take, we are very particular about what our children watch and we monitor all that. During a children's movie, you will have trailers of adult movies coming in with all kinds of scenes. When you go pass through schools, in order to drop your kids and to pick them up, you'll find all adult, all kinds of posters, movie posters along the way. So where's the question of censorship really? We are so concerned about, in fact, the censor board is often accused of being prudish rather than prudent. There again, I think, you know, when it comes to the constitution of these members, you know, how exactly are the members of the censor board constituted? These are issues we really need to delve into. But I think there has to be a golden mean. There has to be a fine balance. As far as religious sentiments are concerned, I think there has to be some kind of a touch-me-not approach there. But anything else in terms of artistic freedom, Justice Krishna Iyer has remarked in many judgments, where he even talks about the land of the Kama Sutra and the temples and all the sexual depictions that he talks about. But he says we need to be a little more mature in our thinking. That said, I for one believe that religious sentiments must be respected. And if filmmakers are kind of enter into that area, then that's really a slippery slope.
Thank you. Thank you, Honorable Advocate Meyyappan.
I was invited for a speech, during the Perumal Murugan Madhurabhagam case. And they were on and off. And I said, we should be, you expect me to, take this in the stride. I'm Hindu. You expect me to take this in the stride. I would just like to place on the table that, Karnan and Lord Jesus, they were all born of the same technology. I don't know whether it was IVF or whatever technology. And if they are both mythology, then both are mythology. And if they are true, then they were all born of the same technology. And here we are talking about a particular situation where a woman who wanted to get, become a mother. And at that point in time, there were certain systems and rituals and all that. So the point is, we are not able to, digest when something close to our heart, is touched upon. And I think we all should, develop, an open mind, like you said, sir. And again, we shouldn't have a committee upon a committee or a board upon a board. But again, it all boils down to the individual to develop, the characteristic. And it was a wonderful...
But you actually made very valid points, sir, there. As far as technology, as you mentioned, I believe in Christianity. I'm a devout Catholic, and I believe it is not technology. It was Immaculate Conception. But again, Justice Kaul in that judgment, he ends it so beautifully. I mean, you can read that judgment over and over again, where he says, in fact, this a lot of people were quite, I would say, grieved by... Perumal Murugan's outburst. He said the writer Perumal Murugan is dead. Somebody who had wanted to give up writing because of the protests. And finally, Justice Kaul in that judgment said, let's resurrect Perumal Murugan, the writer, and let him do what he's best at, to write.
Yes, very true. Very true. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful assurance, concise, and to the point. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Next is Mr. Venkatesh and Vasanta Kumar.
The erudite speech, it's very wonderful, and it's exciting that Justice Kaul's judgment is very apt to the topic. The excellent speech, Sanjay. Thank you very much.
Mr. Sri Krishna.
Thank you so much for the lecture.
In fact, after Vasant's question, I wanted to say that Vasant has been running a very successful WhatsApp group called Judicial Renaissance. And he's conducted a quiz competition during a quiz for lawyers during the lockdown with more than 500 questions, which he's planning to publish as a book. A lot of people question lawyers and, you know, criticize us, but look at the kind of work that is that's happening behind the scenes. And
my question would be, when compared to the other states of India, in Tamil Nadu, there is a new trend which I could able to see, sir, that in TVs, what they say, in a program which was conducted last year, it was a debate, of course. It's a Tamilian party where the leader of the party was saying that I'll burn the constitution, which is really condemnable. And moreover, they were even seeking for a separate Tamil Nadu, which was also the words which he was saying. So what I'm not commenting on anybody here. I am just asking you, this much extent they are going in the field of freedom of expression. What is your opinion about, as it is a live debate and they are just attending the debate without even basic knowledge on the constitution or anything. Your opinion about it and how this can be restricted by the television
anchors
and also the television.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's a, I think a justifiable apprehension that you have when you've been frank enough to raise it. I think when it comes to talking about the unity and integrity of the country, there can be no compromise on that. In fact, that is there as one of the reasonable restrictions. It's actually the first reasonable restriction to free speech under Article 19.2 of the Constitution. After the Bible, for me, the next book that I really, that is very important to me is the Constitution of India. We swear by the Constitution of India. Every advocate has taken an oath to bear allegiance to the Constitution of India, and therefore there can be no quarrel with that point either. As far as the role of anchors, television anchors is concerned, it is important that's why many of these live debates have a disclaimer saying that the views of the panelists are personal and the channel or the editorial policies of the channel do not necessarily subscribe to the views of individual panelists. That's some kind of a disclaimer which may give them a limited amount of legal immunity should the matter go to court. It's important for you to actually vet panelists before you call them for a debate. You know, there are the usual, what we call the usual suspects. When I was in NDTV, we would have a list of panelists on certain topics who would be ready to come, who would be reasonably eloquent. And what we would consider safe panelists, that people really don't shoot their mouth off and say things that could be objectionable, that could lead to unnecessary controversies. While controversy is not a bad word for the media. The media, in fact, survives and thrives on controversies. However, anything which is legally objectionable, that is something that is a matter for concern. Channels, I think anchors should be more circumspect. The moment somebody is going off at a tangent or saying things which are not meant to be said, I think that's when you need to cut them off. That's the role of an anchor, is not merely to ask questions and not merely to read out from a teleprompter. An anchor, that's the difference between a journalist and a news reader. A news reader, those who read news, especially in the vernacular channels, read from a text. But a news anchor is somebody who is ideally a person who's been on the field, who's been there, done that, a veteran news person, who then graduates to being an anchor and who then asks questions. So an anchor should be knowledgeable. He should know at least basic legal knowledge. In fact, not long ago, the Bar Council had made a very interesting and a very, I would say, a pertinent observation that at least the legal correspondent should have some kind of legal background or law degree. They said, I don't know what happened to that afterwards. But it's important for everybody, all the news people to have. In fact, I have even suggested that all news channels should have an in-house or at least outsourced legal resource to vet their scripts, to give them broad guidelines, to draw up editorial codes of conduct in live telecast. Because what does an anchor actually do when somebody shoots his mouth off? The only thing you can do is the standard trick that people do is we'll slide into a short commercial break. A lot of people can do that as a strategy. But then when you come back, then maybe during the break, you can tell the person to kind of make sure that they tone down their rhetoric or they don't say things which are objectionable. Other than that, once somebody, for instance, is a person coming for the first time on a show and he says something which is objectionable, you can't do anything about that. The only due diligence is restricted to ensuring that they are vetted to some extent and that they actually are cut off the moment they say something. And you know, there's also in television, live television, there's actually an 8-second lag. 8 seconds is a lag. That is from the time actually what you see on the screen to watch that what is actually happening in the studio. There's 8 seconds. But sometimes when something really bad is said, technically it is possible for somebody in the production control room to chop it off and ensure that it doesn't go on air, that it can be beeped. That is a technical, technological possibility.
And moreover, I will continue for with the 2 seconds question. I'm so sorry.
Please.
Because please. If what my question would, I'll continue with this. When the program is being conducted and the statements which is made by a leader, a political leader or a leader of a group, like this, which I have already told that burning the constitution or something like that, which is against the public policy, which is against the rules of the country, which is just
if
like
they
that.
If you have a problem with any constitutional provision, let them challenge it in court. The way to you know, dissent here as far as the constitution or the law is concerned is to challenge that law in court. To challenge it through a writ petition or whatever, not burning the constitution. That's something.
Yes, that's what. This is a statement which is made by him. That's why I'm saying it.
Very unfortunate.
Moreover, it is against the public policy. Is there anything by which we can restrain this kind of person from attending any more debates in any television? That's my question. Is there any possibility?
There has to be some self-regulation by the channels concerned. Maybe. The channels concerned, if it's brought to their notice, they should probably not call panelists who make these statements again. In law, in fact, when it comes to public interest litigation, I think in Tamil Nadu, you have a provision called, you know, vexatious litigants. So you can file an application to declare somebody a vexatious litigant. Mm. Perhaps in some ways, there needs to be some kind of a legal provision where those who are repeated offenders are not, but there's some kind of at least a temporary embargo on their participation in debates if they don't express regret for something like this.
Yes, yes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Sanjay, I think I have one more doubt. I think find a clash between Article 19B, 1B and Section 124A of IPC, sedition. So whenever there is some kind of protest by a group of people, I don't mean any individuals or religious group or any splinter groups of Indian events. But normally, whoever is the ruling party, they immediately resort to an FIR under Section 124A. Do you approve the view of governments using 124A as what is called a counterblast or a response or the voice to be scuttled by taking umbrage under Section 124A as against the splinter letter of Article 191B?
Yes, I think, see, again, the reasonable restrictions, as I said, there are 9 reasonable restrictions, unity and integrity of the country. We must understand here, you know, any law we go beyond the legislative intent of any statute. Similarly, in this case, you must understand that the Indian Penal Code of 1860 vintage, many of the laws were primarily designed to quell any popular uprising. They did not want, you know, people to join the freedom movement, and therefore some of these laws were things, especially even 141. So the law that circumscribes dissent was actually of, you know, of 1860 vintage, or even when it comes to sedition, and to prevent any popular uprising by Indians against the British. So that was more the legislative intent behind that the code. As far as this is concerned, the Supreme Court has come to the rescue of citizens when it comes to sedition, especially. They have said, in fact, I think it was Jagjeevan Ram case where they use the expression spark in a power keg. It's not merely bringing about disaffection. It's not merely saying something against the state, but giving a call to violence to overthrow. So there has to be something. The anticipated danger must not be too remote. If I'm not mistaken, these are the words used by the Supreme Court in that case. It's a landmark case on the point. So there has to be something beyond mere words that lead to incitement. That really, so therefore, I don't see a clash between 19.1A and 124A of the IPC. In fact, 19.2 takes care of that. It answers that question. And of course, interpreted by the Supreme Court in several landmark judgments, including this judgment, Jagjeevan Ram case, where they use the expression spark in a power keg.
Now, I'm very happy to say that this is one of the best sessions we had in our webinar.
Thank you, sir.
The 38th session. And I should really wholeheartedly thank you for the brilliant way in which you handled the session.
Thank you. Thank you very much for calling me.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.